Recorded Books and RB Digital present Mutineer's Moon by David Weber. Narrated by Jonathan Todd Ross. Into the Field of Fire. The tunnel seemed endless, yet the end was upon him almost before he realized it, and he lunged up another ladder. The shaft was sealed, but he was already probing at it, spotting the catch, heaving it up with a mighty shoulder. He burst into the night air, and his senses were suddenly afire with more power sources, more combat armor, coming from behind in the prodigious leaps of jump gear and waiting in the woods ahead as well. He tried to unlimber his own energy gun, but a torrent of energy crashed over him, and he cried out as every implant in his body screamed in protest. He writhed, fighting it, clinging to the torment of awareness. It was a capture field, not a killing blast of energy, but something infinitely worse. A police device that locked his synthetic muscles with brutal power. He toppled forward under the impetus of his last charge, crashing to the ground half in and half out of the tunnel. He fought the encroaching darkness, smashing at it with all the fury of his enraged will, but it swept over him. The last thing he saw was a tornado of light as the trees exploded with energy fire. He carried the vision down into the dark with him, dimly aware of its importance. And then, as his senses faded at last, he realized it wasn't directed at him. It was raking the ground behind him and cutting down the mutineers who had pursued him. Book 1. Chapter 1. The huge command deck was as calm, as peacefully dim as ever, silent but for the small background sounds of environmental recordings. The bulkheads were invisible beyond the projection of star-specked space and the blue-white shape of a life-bearing world. It was exactly as it ought to be, exactly as it always had been. Tranquil, well-ordered, as divorced from chaos as any setting could possibly be. But Captain Druaga's face was grim as he stood beside his command chair, and data flowed through his neural feeds. He felt the wickering lightning of energy weapons like heated ions. Engineering no longer responded, not surprisingly, and he'd lost both Biocontrol 1 and 3. The hangar decks belonged to no one. He'd sealed them against the mutineers, but Anu's butchers had blocked the transit shafts with grab fields covered by heavy weapons. He still held fire control and most of the external systems, but communications had been the mutineers' primary target. The first explosion had taken it out, and even an Utu-class ship mounted only a single hypercom. He could neither move the ship nor report what had happened. And his loyalists were losing. Druaga deliberately relaxed his jaw before his teeth could grind together. In the 7,000 years since the Fourth Imperium crawled back into space from the last surviving world of the Third, there had never been a mutiny aboard a capital ship of Battlefleet. At best, he would go down in history as the captain whose crew had turned against him and been savagely suppressed. At worst, he would not go down in history at all. The status report ended, and he sighed and shook himself. The mutineers were hugely outnumbered, but they had the priceless advantage of surprise, and Anu had planned with care. Druaga snorted. No doubt the academy teachers would have been proud of his tactics. But at least, and thank the Maker for it, he was only the chief engineer. Not a bridge officer. There were command codes of which he had no knowledge.
Dahak, Druaga said.
Yes, Captain.
The calm, mellow voice came from everywhere and nowhere, filling the command deck.
How long before the mutineers reach Command 1?
3 standard hours, Captain, plus or minus 15%.
They can't be stopped?
Negative, Captain. They control all approaches to Command 1, and they are pushing back loyal personnel at almost all points of contact.
Of course they were, Draga thought bitterly. They had combat armor and heavy weapons. The vast majority of his loyalists did not. He looked around the deserted command deck once more. Gunnery was unmanned, and plotting engineering battle comp, astrogation. When the alarms went, only he had managed to reach his post before the mutineers cut power to the transit shafts. Just him. And to get here, he'd had to kill two subverted members of his own staff when they pounced on him like assassins.
All right, Dahak, he told the all-surrounding voice grimly. If all we still hold is Bio-2 and the weapon systems, we'll use them. Cut Bio-1 and 3 out of the circuit.
Executed, the voice said instantly. But it will take the mutineers no more than an hour to put them back online under manual.
Granted, but it's long enough. Go to Condition Red 2, internal.
There was a momentary pause, and Druaga suppressed a bitter smile.
You have no suit, Captain, the voice said unemotionally. If you set Condition Red 2, you will die.
I know.
Druaga wished he was as calm as he sounded, but he knew Dahak's bio readouts gave him the lie. Yet it was the only chance he, or rather the Imperium, had.
You will give a 10-minute warning count, he continued,
sitting down in his command chair.
That should give everyone time to reach a lifeboat. Once everyone's evacuated, our external weapons will become effective. You will carry out immediate decon, but you will allow only loyal personnel to re-enter until you receive orders to the contrary from your new captain. Any mutinous personnel who approach within 5,000 kilometers before loyal officers have reasserted control will be destroyed in space.
Understood. Druaga could have sworn the voice spoke more softly. Comp sent core programs require authentication of this order, however.
Alpha 8, Sigma 9 or 9 or 7 Delta 4 Alpha, he said flatly.
Authentication code acknowledged and accepted, the voice responded. Please specify time for implementation.
Immediately, Draga said,
and wondered if he spoke so quickly to avoid losing his nerve. Acknowledged. Do you wish to listen to the 10 count, Captain?
No, Dahak, Draga said very softly.
Understood, the voice replied, and Druaga closed his eyes. It was a draconian solution, if it could be called a solution at all. Red 2 internal was the next to final defense against hostile incursion. It opened every ventilation trunk, something which could be done only on the express authenticated order of the ship's commander to flood the entire volume of the stupendous starship with chemical and radioactive agents. By its very nature, Red 2 exempted no compartment, including this one. The ship would become uninhabitable, a literal death trap, and only the central computer which he controlled could decontaminate. The system had never been intended for this contingency, but it would work. Mutineers and loyalists alike would be forced to flee, and no lifeboat ever built could stand up to Dahak's weaponry. Of course, Druaga wouldn't be alive to see the end, but at least his command would be held for the Imperium. And if Red 2 failed, there was always Red 1.
Dahak,
he said suddenly, never opening his eyes.
Yes, Captain.
Category 1 order,
Druaga said formally.
Recording, the voice said.
I, Senior Fleet Captain Druaga, commanding Officer Imperial Fleet Vessel Dahak, hull number 172291,
Druaga said even more formally.
Having determined to my satisfaction that a Class 1 threat to the Imperium exists aboard my vessel, do now issue pursuant to Fleet Regulation 71 Section 193, Subsection 71,
a Category 1 order to Dahak Computer Central. Authentication code Alpha 8 Delta Sigma Niner Niner 7 Delta 4 Omega. Authentication code acknowledged and accepted, the voice said, coolly. Standing by to accept Category 1 orders, please specify. Primary mission of this unit now becomes suppression of mutinous personnel, in accordance with instructions already issued, Duraga said crisply. If previously specified measures fail to restore control to loyal personnel, said mutinous elements will be destroyed by any practicable means, including, if necessary, the setting of condition Red 1, internal, and total destruction of this vessel. These orders carry priority Alpha. Acknowledged, the voice said, and Druaga let his head rest upon the cushioned back of his chair. It was done. Even if Anu somehow managed to reach Command 1, he could not abort the order Dahak had just acknowledged. The captain relaxed. At least, he thought, it should be fairly painless. 9 minutes and counting, the computer voice said. And Fleet Captain E. Anu, Chief Engineer of the Ship of the Line, Dahak, cursed. Damn Druaga. He hadn't expected the captain to reach his bridge alive, much less counted on this. Druaga had always seemed such an unimaginative, rote-bound, dutiful automaton. What shall we do, Anu? Commander Inanna's eyes were anxious through her armor's visor, and he did not blame her. Fall back to Bay 91, he grated furiously. But that's... I know. We'll just have to use them ourselves. Now get our people moving, Commander. Yes, sir. Commander Inanna said, and Anu threw himself into the central transit shaft. The shaft walls screamed past him, though he felt no subjective sense of motion, and his lips drew back in an ugly snarl. His first attempt had failed, but he had a trick or two of his own, tricks even Druaga didn't know about, break or take him. Copper minnows exploded away from Dahak. Lifeboats crowded with loyal crew members fanned out over the glaciated surface of the alien planet, seeking refuge, and scattered among them were other larger shapes. Still only motes compared to the ship itself, their masses were measured in thousands upon thousands of tons. And they plummeted together, outspeeding the smaller lifeboats. Anu had no intention of remaining in space where Druaga, assuming he was still alive, might recognize that he and his followers had not abandoned ship in lifeboats, and used Dahak's weapons to pick off his sublight parasites as easily as a child swatting flies. The engineer sat in the command chair of the parasite Oser, watching the gargantuan bulk of the camouflaged mothership dwindle with distance, and his smile was ugly. He needed that ship to claim his destiny, but he could still have it. Once the programs he'd buried in the engineering computers did their job, every power room aboard Dahak would be so much rubble. Emergency power would keep CompSent going for a time, but when it faded, CompSent would die. And with its death, Dahak's Hulk would be his. Entering atmosphere, sir, Commander Inanna said from the first officer's couch. Chapter 2. Papa Mike Control, this is Papa Mike 1X-Ray. Do you copy? Lieutenant Commander Colin Maclntyre's radar pinged softly. As the Copernicus mass driver hurled another few tons of lunar rock towards the catcher ships of the Eden 3 habitat, and he watched its outgoing trace on the scope as he waited, reveling in the joy of solo flight, for secondary mission control at Tereshkova to respond.
1X-ray, Papa Mike Control, a deep voice acknowledged. Proceed.
Papa Mike Control, 1X-ray orbital insertion burn complete. It looks good from here. Over.
1X-ray, that's affirmative. Do you want a couple of orbits to settle in before initiating? Negative control, the whole idea is to do this on my own, right?
Affirmative, one x-ray.
Let's do it then. I show a green board. Pasha, do you confirm?
That's an affirmative, one x-ray. And we also show you approaching our transmission horizon, Colin. Communications loss in 20 seconds. You are cleared to initiate the exercise.
Papa Mike Control, one x-ray copies. See you guys in a little while.
Roger, one x-ray. Your turn to buy anyway.
Like hell it is. Maclntyre laughed. But whatever Papa Mike Control might have replied was cut off as one x-ray swept beyond the lunar horizon and lost signal. Maclntyre ran down his final checklist with extra care. It had been surprisingly hard for the test mission's planners to pick an orbit that would keep him clear of nearside's traffic and cover a totally unexplored portion of the moon's surface. But Farside was populated only by a handful of observatories and deep system radio arrays, and the routing required to find virgin territory combined with the close orbit the survey instruments needed would put him out of touch with the rest of the human race for the next little bit, which was a novel experience even for an astronaut these days. He finished his list and activated his instruments, then sat back and hummed, drumming on the arms of his acceleration couch to keep time as his onboard computers flickered through the mission programs. It was always possible to hit a glitch, but there was little he could do about it if it happened. He was a pilot, thoroughly familiar with the electronic gizzards of his one-man Beagle 3 survey vehicle, but he had only the vaguest idea about how this particular instrument package functioned. The rate of technical progress in the 70 years since Armstrong was enough to leave any non-specialist hopelessly behind outside his own field, and the geosciences team back at Shepherd Center had wandered down some peculiar paths to produce their current generation of esoteric peakers and priors. Gravitonic resonance was a marvelous term, and Maclntyre often wished he knew exactly what it meant. But not enough to spend another 6 or 8 years tacking on extra degrees, so he contented himself with understanding what the planetary proctoscope, as some anonymous wag had christened it, did rather than how it did it. Maneuvering thrusters nudged his beagle into precisely the proper attitude, and Maclntyre bent a sapient gaze upon the readouts. Those, at least, he understood. Which was just as well, since he was slated as primary survey pilot for the Prometheus mission, and... His humming paused suddenly, dying in mid-note, and his eyebrows crooked. Now, that was odd. A malfunction? He punched keys, and his crooked eyebrows became a frown. According to the diagnostics, everything was functioning perfectly, but whatever else the moon might be, it wasn't hollow. He tugged on his prominent nose, watching the preposterous data appear on the displays. The printer beside him hummed, producing a hard copy graphic representation of the raw numbers, and he tugged harder. According to his demented instruments, someone must have been a busy little beaver down there. It looked, for all the world, as if a vast labyrinth of tunnels, passages, and God knew what had been carved out under 80 kilometers of solid lunar rock. He allowed himself a muttered imprecation. Less than a year from mission date and one of their primary survey systems, and a NASA design at that, had decided to go gaga. But the thing had worked perfectly in atmospheric tests over Nevada and Siberia, so what the hell had happened now? He was still tugging on his nose when the proximity alarm jerked him up in his couch. Damnation. He was all alone back here, so what the hell was that? That was a blip less than 100 kilometers astern, and closing fast. How had something that big gotten this close before his radar caught it? According to his instruments, it was at least the size of one of the old Saturn V boosters. His jaw dropped as the bogey made a crisp, clean, instantaneous 90-degree turn. Apparently, the laws of motion had been repealed on behalf of whatever it was. But whatever else it was doing, it was also maneuvering to match his orbit.
Even as he watched, the stranger was slowing to pace him. Colin Maclntyre's level-headedness was one reason he'd been selected for the first joint U.S.-Soviet interstellar flight crew. But the hair on the back of his neck stood on end as his craft suddenly shuddered. It was as if something had touched the Beagle's hull, something massive enough to shake a 100-ton, atmosphere-capable, variable-geometry spacecraft. That shook him out of his momentary state of shock. Whatever this was, no one had told him to expect it, and that meant it belonged to neither NASA nor the Russians. His hands flew over his maneuvering console, waking flaring thrusters, and the Beagle quivered. She quivered, but she didn't budge. And cold sweat beaded Maclntyre's face as she continued serenely along her orbital path, attitude unchanged. That couldn't possibly be happening, but then none of this could be happening, could it? He chopped that thought off and punched more keys. One thing he had was plenty of maneuvering mass. Beagles were designed for lengthy deployments, and he'd tanked from the Ruskies' Gagarin platform before departure on his translunar flight plan. And the ship shuddered wildly as her main engines came alive. The full power burn should have slammed him back in his couch and sent the survey ship hurtling forward. But the thundering engines had no more effect than his maneuvering thrusters, and he sagged in his seat. Then his jaw clenched as the Beagle finally started to move, not away from the stranger, but towards it. Whatever that thing on his radar was, it was no figment of his imagination. His mind raced. The only possible explanation was that the blip had stuck him with some sort of tractor beam. And that represented more than any mere quantum leap in applied physics, which meant the blip did not come from any Terran technology. He did not indulge himself with any more dirty words like impossible or incredible, for it was all too evident that it was possible. By some unimaginable quirk of fate, somebody else had come calling, just as mankind was about to reach out to the stars. But whoever they were, he couldn't believe they'd just happened to turn up while he was far-side with blacked-out communications. They'd been waiting for him, or someone like him, so they must have been observing Earth for quite some time. But if they had, they'd had time to make their presence known, and to monitor terrestrial communication systems. Presumably, then, they knew how to contact him but had chosen not to do so. And that suggested a lot of things, none particularly pleasant. The salient point, however, was that they obviously intended to collect him, Beagle and all, for purposes of their own. And Colin Maclntyre did not intend to be collected if he could help it. The exhaustive Prometheus mission briefings on first contact flowed through his mind, complete with all the injunctions to refrain from hostile acts. But it was one thing to consider yourself expendable in pursuit of communication with aliens you might have gone calling on. It was quite another when they dropped in on you and started hauling you in like a fish. His face hardened, and he flipped up the plastic shield over the fire control panel. There'd been wrung hands at the notion of arming a peaceful interstellar probe, but the military, which provided so many of the pilots, had enjoyed the final word. And Maclntyre breathed a silent breath of thanks that this was a full-dress training mission as weapon systems came alive. He fed targeting data from his radar and reached for the firing keys, then paused. They hadn't tried talking to him, but neither had he tried talking to them. "Unknown spacecraft, this is NASA Papa Mike 1 X-ray," he said crisply into his radio. "Release my ship and stand off." There was no answer, and he glowered at the blip. "Release my ship or I will fire on you." Still no reply, and his lips thinned. All right. If the miserable buggers didn't even want to talk. Three small, powerful missiles blasted away from the Beagle. They weren't nukes, but each carried a 300-kilo warhead, and they had a perfect targeting setup. He tracked them all the way in on radar. And
absolutely nothing happened. Commander Maclntyre sagged in his couch. Those missiles hadn't been spoofed by ECM or exploded short of the target. They just vanished. And the implications were disturbing. Most disturbing. He cut his engines. There was no point wasting propellant, and he and his captors would be clearing Heinlein's transmission horizon shortly anyway. He tried to remember if any of the other Beagles were up. Judging by his own total lack of success, they would be none too effective against whoever they were. But nothing else in this vicinity was armed at all. He rather thought Vlad Chernikov was at Tereshkova, but the flight schedules for the Prometheus crews had grown so hectic of late, it was hard to keep track. His Beagle continued to move towards the intruder, and now he was turning slowly, nose on to it. He leaned back as nonchalantly as possible, watching through his canopy. He ought to see them just about now. Yes, there they were. And mighty disappointing they were, too. He didn't really know what he'd expected, but that flattened, featureless, round-tipped, double-ended cylinder certainly wasn't it. They were barely a kilometer clear now, but aside from the fact that the thing was obviously artificial, it seemed disappointingly undramatic. There was no sign of engines, hatches, ports, communication arrays, nothing at all but smooth, mirror-bright metal. Or at least he assumed it was metal. He checked his chronometer. Communications should come back in any second now, and his lips stretched in a humorless smile at how Heinlein Base was going to react when the pair of them came over the radar horizon. It ought to be... They stopped. Just like that, with no apparent sense of deceleration, no reaction exhaust from the cylinder, no anything. He gaped at the intruder in disbelief. Or, no, not disbelief exactly. More like a desire to disbelieve. Especially when he realized they were motionless relative to the lunar surface, neither climbing away nor tumbling closer. The fact that the intruder could do that was somehow more terrifying than anything else that had happened. A terror made only worse by the total, prosaic familiarity of his own cockpit. And he clutched the arms of his couch, fighting an irrational conviction that he had to be falling. But then they were moving again, zipping back the way they'd come at a velocity that beggared the imagination, all with absolutely no sense of acceleration. His attitude relative to the cylinder altered once more. It was behind him now, its rounded tip barely 100 meters clear of his own engines, and he watched the lunar surface blur below him. His Beagle and its captor swooped lower, arrowing straight for a minor crater, and his toes curled inside his flight boots, while his hands tried to rip the arms off his couch. The things he'd already seen that cylinder do told his intellect they were not about to crash, but instinct was something else again. He fought his panic stubbornly, refusing to yield to it, yet his gasp of relief was explosive when the floor of the crater suddenly zipped open. The cylinder slowed to a few 100 kilometers per hour, and Maclntyre felt the comfort of catatonia beckoning to him. But something made him fight it as obstinately as he had fought his panic. Whatever had him wasn't going to find him curled up and drooling when they finally stopped by God. A mighty tunnel enveloped them, a good 200 meters across and lit by brilliant strip lights. Stone walls glittered with an odd sheen, as if the rock had been fused glass slick, but that didn't last long. They slid through a multiply hatch big enough for a pair of carriers, and the tunnel walls were suddenly metallic, a bronze-like metal gleaming in the light. Stretching so far ahead of him, even its mighty bore dwindled to a gleaming dot with distance. Their speed dropped still further, and more hatches slid past. Dozens of hatches, most as large as the one that had admitted them to this impossible metal gullet. His mind reeled at the structure's sheer size, but he retained enough mental balance to apologize silently to the proctoscope's designers. One huge hatch flicked open with the suddenness of a striking snake.
Whoever was directing their flight curved away from the tunnel, slipping neatly through the open hatch, and his beagle settled without a jar to a floor of the same bronze-like alloy. They were in a dimly lit metal cavern at least a kilometer across, its floor dotted with neatly parked duplicates of the cylinder that had captured him. He gawked through the canopy, wishing a beagle's equipment list ran to sidearms. After his missile's failure, he supposed there was no reason to expect a handgun to work either, but it would have been comforting to be able to try. He licked his lips. If nothing else, the titanic size of this structure ruled out the possibility that the intruders had only recently discovered the solar system. But how had they managed to build it without anyone noticing? And then, at last, his radio hummed to life. "Good afternoon, Commander Maclntyre," a deep, mellow voice said politely. "I regret the rather unorthodox nature of your arrival here, but I had no choice. Nor, I am afraid, do you."
Who are you?"
Maclntyre demanded a bit hoarsely, then paused and cleared his throat.
"What do you want with me?"
he asked more levelly. "I fear that answering those questions will be a bit complicated," the voice said imperturbably. "But you may call me Dahak, Commander." Chapter 3 Maclntyre drew a deep breath. At least the whatever they were finally talking to him, and in English too, which inspired a small welcome spurt of righteous indignation. "Your apologies might carry a little more weight if you'd bother to communicate with me before you kidnapped me," he said coldly.
"I realize that," his captor replied, "but it was impossible."
"Oh? You seem to have overcome your problems rather nicely since." Maclntyre was comforted to find he could still achieve a nasty tone.
"Your communication devices are rather primitive, Commander." The words were almost apologetic. "My tender was not equipped to interface with them."
"You're doing quite well. Why didn't you talk to me?"
"It was not possible. The tender's stealth systems enclosed both you and itself in a field impervious to radio transmissions. It was possible for me to communicate with the tender using my own communication systems, but there was no onboard capability to relay my words to you. Once more, I apologize for any inconvenience you may have suffered."
Maclntyre bit off a giggle at how calmly this Dahak person produced a neat 1000% understatement like inconvenience, and the incipient hysteria of his own sound helped sober him. He ran shaky fingers through his sandy brown hair, feeling as if he had taken a punch or two too many.
"All right, Dahak, you've got me. What do you intend to do with me?"
"I would be most grateful if you would leave your vessel and come to the command deck, Commander."
"Just like that?
I beg your pardon?
You expect me to step out of my ship and surrender just like that?"
"Excuse me, it has been some time since I have communicated with a human, so perhaps I have been clumsy. You are not a prisoner, Commander. Or perhaps you are. I should like to treat you as an honored guest, but honesty compels me to admit that I cannot allow you to leave. However, I assure you upon the honor of the fleet that no harm will come to you."
Insane as it all sounded, Maclntyre felt a disturbing tendency to believe it. This Dahak could have lied and promised release as the alien's ambassador to humanity, but he hadn't. The finality of that "cannot allow you to leave" was more than a bit chilling, but its very openness was a sort of guarantor of honesty, wasn't it? Or did he simply want it to be? But even if Dahak was a congenital liar, he had few options. His consumables could be stretched to about 3 weeks, so he could cower in his beagle that long, assuming Dahak was prepared to let him. But what then? Escape was obviously impossible, so his only real choice was how soon he came out, not whether or not he did so. Besides, he felt a stubborn disinclination to show how frightened he was.
"All right," he said finally. "I'll come."
"Thank you, Commander. You will find the environment congenial, though you may, of course, suit up if you prefer." Thank you. Maclntyre's sarcasm was automatic, but again, it was only a matter of time before he had to rely on whatever atmosphere the voice chose to provide. And he sighed. Then I suppose I'm ready. Very well. A vehicle is now approaching your vessel. It should be visible to your left. Maclntyre craned his neck and caught a glimpse of movement as a double-ended bullet shape, about the size of a compact car, slid rapidly closer, gliding a foot or so above the floor. It came to a halt under the leading edge of his port wing, exactly opposite his forward hatch, and a door slid open. Light spilled from the opening, bright and welcoming in the dim metal cavern. I see it, he said, pleased to note that his voice sounded almost normal again. Excellent. If you would be so kind as to board it then? I'm on my way, he said, and released his harness. He stood and discovered yet another strangeness. Maclntyre had put in enough time on Luna, particularly in the 3 years he'd spent training for the Prometheus mission, to grow accustomed to its reduced gravity, which was why he almost fell flat on his face when he rose. His eyes widened. He couldn't be certain, but his weight felt about right for a standard G, which meant these bozos could generate gravity to order. Well, why not? The one thing that was crystal clear was that these, call them people, were far, far ahead of his own 21st century technology, right? His muscles tightened despite Dahak's reassurances as he opened the hatch. But the air that swirled about him had no immediate lethal effect. In fact, it smelled far better than the inside of the Beagle. It was crisp and a bit chill, its freshness carrying just a kiss of a spicy, evergreen-like scent, and some of his tension eased as he inhaled deeply. It was harder to feel terrified of aliens who breathed something like this, always assuming they hadn't manufactured it purely for his own consumption, of course. It was 4.5 meters to the floor, and he found himself wishing his hosts had left gravity well enough alone as he swung down the emergency handholds and approached the patiently waiting vehicle with caution. It seemed innocuous enough. There were 2 comfortable-looking chairs proportioned for something the same size and shape as a human, but no visible control panel. The most interesting thing, though, was that the upper half of the vehicle's hull was transparent from the inside. From the outside, it looked exactly the same as the bronze-colored floor under his feet. He shrugged and climbed aboard, noticing that the silently suspended vehicle didn't even quiver under his weight. He chose the right-hand seat, then made himself sit motionless as the padded surface squirmed under him. A moment later, it had reconfigured itself exactly to the contours of his body, and the hatch licked shut. "Are you ready, Commander?" His host's voice came from no apparent source, and Maclntyre nodded. "Let her rip," he said, and the vehicle began to move. At least there was a sense of movement this time. He sank firmly back into the seat under at least 2G's acceleration. No wonder the thing was bullet-shaped. The little vehicle rocketed across the cavern, straight at a featureless metal wall, and he flinched involuntarily. But a hatch popped open an instant before they hit, and they darted straight into another brightly lit bore, this one no wider than 2 or 3 of the vehicles in which he rode. He considered speaking further to Dahak, but the only real purpose would be to bolster his own nerve and prove his equanimity. And he was damned if he'd chatter to hide the heebie-jeebies. So he sat silently, watching the walls flash by, and tried to estimate their velocity. It was impossible. The walls weren't featureless, but speed reduced them to a blur that was long before the acceleration eased into the familiar sensation of freefall. And Maclntyre felt a sense of wonder pressing the last panic from his soul. This base dwarfed the vastest human installation he'd ever seen. How in God's name had a bunch of aliens managed an engineering project of such magnitude without anyone even noticing? There was a fresh spurt of acceleration and a sideways surge of inertia as the vehicle swept through a curved junction and darted into yet another tunnel. It seemed to stretch forever, like the one that had engulfed his beagle, and his vehicle scooted down its very center. He kept waiting to arrive, but it was a very, very long time before their headlong pace began to slow. His first warning was the movement of the vehicle's interior. The entire cockpit swiveled smoothly, until he was facing back the way he'd come, and then the drag of deceleration hit him. It went on, and the blurred walls beyond the transparent canopy slowed. He could make out details once more, including the maws of other tunnels, and then they slowed virtually to a walk. They swerved gently down one of those intersecting tunnels, little wider than the vehicle itself, then slid alongside a side opening and stopped. The hatch flicked soundlessly open. "If you will debark, Commander," the mellow voice invited, and Maclntyre shrugged and stepped down onto what looked for all the world like shag carpeting. The vehicle closed its hatch behind him and slid silently backwards, vanishing the way it had come. "Follow the guide, please, Commander." He looked about blankly for a moment, then saw a flashing light globe hanging in midair. It bobbed twice as if to attract his attention, then headed down a side corridor at a comfortable pace. A 10-minute walk took him past numerous closed doors, each labeled in a strangely attractive, utterly meaningless flowing script, and air as fresh and cool as the docking caverns blew into his face. There were tiny sounds in the background, so soft and unintrusive, it took him several minutes to notice them, and they were not the mechanical ones he might have expected. Instead, he heard small, soft stirrings, like wind in leaves or the distant call of birds, forming a soothing backdrop that helped one forget the artificiality of the environment. But then the corridor ended abruptly at a hatch of that same bronze-colored alloy. It was bank vault huge, and it bore the first ornamentation he'd seen. A stupendous three-headed beast writhed across it, with arched wings poised to launch it into flight. Its trio of upthrust heads faced in different directions, as if to watch all approaches at once, and cat-like forefeet were raised before it, claws half-extended as if to simultaneously proffer and protect the spired glory starburst floating just above them. Maclntyre recognized it instantly, though the enormous bas-relief dragon was neither eastern nor western in interpretation. And he paused to rub his chin, wondering what a creature of earthly mythology was doing in an extraterrestrial base hidden on Earth's moon. But that question was a strangely distant thing, surpassed by a greater wonder that was almost awe as the huge, stunningly lifelike eyes seemed to measure him with a calm, dispassionate majesty that might yet become terrible wrath if he transgressed. He never knew precisely how long he stood staring at the dragon and stared at by it. But in the end, his light globe guide gave a rather impatient twitch and drifted closer to the hatch. Maclntyre shook himself and followed with a wry half-smile, and the bronze portal slid open as he approached. It was at least 15 centimeters thick, yet it was but the first of a dozen equally thick hatches, forming a closed-spaced, immensely strong barrier, and he felt small and fragile as he followed the globe down the silently opening passage. The multi-ply panels licked shut behind him, equally silently, and he tried to suppress a feeling of imprisonment. But then his destination appeared before him at last, and he stopped, all other considerations forgotten. The spherical chamber was larger than the old war room under Cheyenne Mountain, larger even than main mission control at Shepherd, and the stark perfection of its form, the featureless sweep of its colossal walls, pressed down upon him as if to impress his tininess upon him. He stood on a platform thrust out from one curving wall, a transparent platform, dotted with a score of comfortable couch-like chairs before what could only be control consoles, though there seemed to be remarkably few readouts and inputs, and the far side of the chamber was dominated by a tremendous view screen. The blue-white globe of Earth floated in its center, and the cloud-swirled loveliness caught at Maclntyre's throat. he was back in his first shuttle cockpit, seeing that azure and argent beauty for the first time, as if the mind-battering incidents of the past hour had made him freshly aware of his bond with all that planet was and meant. "Please be seated, Commander." The soft, mellow voice broke into his thoughts almost gently, yet it seemed to fill the vast space. "Here." The light globe danced briefly above one padded chair, the one with the largest console, at the very lip of the unrailed platform, and he approached it gingerly. He had never suffered from agoraphobia or vertigo, but it was a long, long way down, and the platform was so transparent he seemed to be striding on air itself as he crossed it. His guide disappeared as he settled into the chair, not even blinking this time as it conformed to his body. And the voice spoke again. "Now, Commander, I shall try to explain what is happening." "You can start," Maclntyre interrupted, determined to be more than a passive listener,
"by explaining how you people managed to build a base this size on our moon without us noticing."
"We built no base, Commander." Maclntyre's green eyes narrowed in irritation.
"Well, somebody sure as hell did," he growled.
"You are suffering under a misapprehension, Commander. This is not a base on your moon. It is your moon." For just an instant, Maclntyre was certain he'd misunderstood.
"What did you say?"
he asked finally. "I said this is your moon, Commander. In point of fact, you are seated on the command bridge of a spacecraft."
"A spacecraft as big as the moon?"
Maclntyre said faintly.
"Correct. A vessel some 3,000, 3202.795 to be precise, of your kilometers in diameter."
"But..."
Maclntyre's voice died in shock. He'd known the installation was huge, but no one could replace the moon without someone noticing, however advanced their technology.
"I don't believe it," he said flatly.
"Nonetheless, it is true."
"It's not possible," Maclntyre said stubbornly.
"If this thing is the size you say, what happened to the real moon?"
"It was destroyed," his informant said calmly, "with the exception of sufficient of its original material to make up the negligible difference in diameter. It was dropped into your sun. It is standard fleet procedure to camouflage picket units or any capital ship that may be required to spend extended periods in systems not claimed by the Imperium."
"You camouflaged your ship as our moon? That's insane."
"On the contrary, Commander. A planetoid-class starship is not an easy object to hide. Replacing an existing moon of appropriate size is by far the simplest means of concealment, particularly when, as in this case, the original surface contours are faithfully recreated as part of the procedure."
"Preposterous. Somebody on Earth would have noticed something going on."
"No, Commander, they would not. In point of fact, your species was not on Earth to observe it."
"What?"
"The events I have just described took place approximately 51,000 of your years ago," his informant said gently.
Maclntyre sagged around his bones. He was mad, he thought calmly. That was certainly the most reasonable explanation.
"Perhaps it would be simpler if I explained from the beginning rather than answering questions," the voice suggested.
"Perhaps it would be simpler if you explained in person," Maclntyre snapped, suddenly savage in his confusion.
"But I am explaining in person," the voice said.
"I mean face to face," Maclntyre grated.
"Unfortunately, Commander, I do not have a face," the voice said, and Maclntyre could have sworn he heard wry amusement in it. "You see, in a sense, you are sitting inside me."
"Inside?" Maclntyre whispered.
"Precisely, Commander. I am Dahak, the central command computer of the Imperial ship of the line Dahak."
"Ah," Maclntyre said softly.
"I beg your pardon," Dahak said calmly. "Shall I continue?" Maclntyre gripped the arms of his chair and closed his eyes, counting slowly to 100.
Sure, he said at last, opening his eyes slowly. Why don't you do that?
Very well. Please observe the visual display, Commander.
Earth vanished, and another image replaced it. It was a sphere as bronze bright as the cylinder that had captured his beagle, but despite the lack of any reference scale, he knew it was far, far larger. The image turned and grew and details became visible, swelling rapidly into vast blisters and domes. There were no visible ports, and he saw no sign of any means of propulsion. The hull was completely featureless but for those smoothly rounded protrusions, until its turning motion brought him face to face with a tremendous replica of the dragon that had adorned the hatch. It sprawled over one face of the sphere like a vast ensign, arrogant and proud, and he swallowed. It covered a relatively small area of the hull, but if that sphere was what he thought it was, this dragon was about the size of Montana. This is Dahak, the voice told him. Hull number 177291, an U2-class planetoid of Battlefleet. Built 52,000 Terran years ago in the Anhur system by the Fourth Imperium. Maclntyre stared at the screen, too entranced to disbelieve. The image of the ship filled it entirely, seeming as if it must fall from the display and crush him, and then it dissolved into a computer-generated schematic of the monster vessel. It was too stupendous for him to register much, and the schematic changed even as he watched, rolling to present him with an exploded polar view of deck after inconceivable deck, as the voice continued. The Utu class were designed both for the line of battle and for independent long-term survey and picket deployment, with core crews of 250,000. Intended optimum deployment time is 25 Terran years, with provision for a 60% increase in personnel during that period. Maximum deployment time is virtually unlimited, assuming crew expansion is contained. In addition to small two-seat fighters that may be employed in either attack or defense, Dahak deploys sublight parasite warships massing up to 80,000 tons, shipboard weaponry centers around hyper-capable missile batteries backed up by direct-fire energy weapons. Weapon payloads range from chemical warheads through fusion, antimatter, and gravitonic warheads. Essentially, Commander, this ship could vaporize your planet. My God, Maclntyre whispered. He wanted to disbelieve. God, how he wanted to. But he couldn't. Sublight propulsion, Dahak went on, ignoring the interruption, relies upon phased gravitonic progression. Your present terminology lacks the reference for an accurate description. But for purposes of visualization, you may consider it a reactionless drive with a maximum attainable velocity of 52.4% that of light. Above that velocity, a vessel of this size would lose phase lock and be destroyed. Unlike previous designs, the Utu class do not rely upon multidimensional drives. What your science fiction writers have dubbed hyperdrives, Commander, for faster-than-light travel. Instead, this ship employs the Incanic drive. You may envision it as the creation of converging artificially generated black holes, which force the vessel out of phase with normal space in a series of instantaneous transpositions between coordinates in normal space. Under Incanic drive, dwell time in normal space between transpositions is approximately 0.75 Terran femtoseconds. The Incanic drive's maximum effective velocity is approximately C6 factorial. While this is lower than that of the latest hyperdrives, Incanic drive vessels have several tactical advantages. Most importantly, they may enter, maneuver in, and leave a supralight state at will, whereas hyperdrive vessels may enter and leave superlight only at pre-selected coordinates. Power generation for the Utu class. Stop. Maclntyre's single word halted Dahak's voice instantly, and he rubbed his eyes slowly, wishing he could wake up at home in bed. "Look," he said finally, "this is all very interesting, Dahak." He felt a bit silly speaking to a machine, even one like this. "But aside from convincing me that this is one mean mother of a ship, it doesn't seem very pertinent. I mean, I'm impressed as hell. But what does anyone need with a ship like this? 3,200 kilometers in diameter, 80,000-ton parasite warships, 200,000-man crews, vaporized planets? Jesus H. Christ! What is this Fourth Imperium? Who in God's name does it need that kind of firepower against? And what the hell is it doing here?"
"I will explain if I may resume my briefing," Dahak said calmly, and Maclntyre snorted, then waved for it to continue. "Thank you, Commander. You are correct. Technical data may be left to the future. But for you to understand my difficulty, and the reason it is your difficulty as well, I must summarize some history. Please understand that much of this represents reconstruction and deduction based upon very scant physical evidence. Briefly, the Fourth Imperium is a political unit, originating upon the planet Birhat in the Bia system, some 7,000 years prior to Dahak's entry into your solar system. As of that time, the Imperium consisted of some 1,500 star systems. It is called the Fourth Imperium because it is the third such interstellar entity to exist within recorded history. The existence of at least one prehistoric Imperium, designated the First Imperium by Imperial historians, has been conclusively demonstrated, although archaeological evidence suggests that, in fact, a minimum of 9 additional prehistoric Imperia intervened between the First and Second Imperium. All, however, were destroyed in part or in whole by the Achul Tani. A formless chill tingled down Maclntyre's spine.
"And just what were the Achul Tani?" he asked, trying to keep his strange, shadowy emotions out of his voice.
"Available data are insufficient for conclusive determinations," Dahak replied. "Fragmentary evidence suggests that the Achul Tani are a single species, possibly of extragalactic origin.
Even the name is a transliteration of a transliteration from an unattested myth of the Second Imperium. More data may have been amassed during actual incursions, but most such information was lost in the general destruction attendant upon such incursions or during the reconstruction that followed them. What has been retained pertains more directly to tactics and apparent objectives. On the basis of that data, historians of the Fourth Imperium conclude that the first such incursion occurred on the close order of 70 million Terran years ago."
70 mil?
Maclntyre chopped himself off. "No species could survive over such an incredible period. Then again, the moon couldn't be an alien starship, could it?" He nodded jerkily for Dahak to continue.
"Supporting evidence may be found upon your own planet, Commander," the computer said calmly. "The sudden disappearance of terrestrial dinosaurs at the end of your Mesozoic era coincides with the first known Achul Tani incursion."
"Many Terran scientists have suggested that this may have been the consequence of a massive meteor impact."
"My own observations suggest that they are correct, and the Achul Tani have always favored large kinetic weapons."
But why? Why would anyone wipe out dinosaurs?"
"The Achul Tani objective," Dahak said precisely,
"appears to be the obliteration of all competing species, wherever situated. While it is unlikely that terrestrial dinosaurs, who are essentially a satisfied life form, might have competed with them, that would not prevent them from striking the planet as a long-term precaution against the emergence of a competitor. Their attention was probably drawn to Earth by the presence of a First Imperium colony, however. I base this conclusion on data that indicate the existence of a First Imperium military installation on your fifth planet."
"Fifth planet?"
Maclntyre parroted, overloaded by what he was hearing.
"You mean, precisely, Commander, the asteroid belt.
It would appear they struck your fifth planet a bit harder than Earth, and it was much smaller and less geologically stable to begin with.
Are you sure?
I have had sufficient time to amass conclusive observational data. In addition, such an act would be consistent with recorded Acheultani tactics and the deduced military policies of the First Imperium, which apparently preferred to place system defense bases upon centrally located non-life-bearing bodies.
Dahak paused, and Maclntyre sat silent, trying to grasp the sheer stretch of time involved. Then the computer spoke again.
"Shall I continue?" it asked, and he managed another nod. "Thank you. Imperial analysts speculate that the periodic Acheultani incursions into this arm of the galaxy represent sweeps in search of potential competitors, what your own military might term search and destroy missions, rather than attempts to expand their imperial sphere. The Acheultani culture would appear to be extremely stable, one might almost say static, for very few technological advances have been observed since the Second Imperium."
The precise reasons for this apparent cultural stasis and for the widely varying intervals between such sweeps are unknown, as is the precise locus from which they originate. While some evidence does suggest an extra-galactic origin for the species,
pattern analysis suggests that the Acheultani currently occupy a region far to the galactic east.
This unfortunately places Sol in an extremely exposed position, as your solar system lies on the eastern fringe of the Imperium.
In short, the Acheultani must pass Sol to reach the Imperium. This has not mattered to your planet of late, as there has been nothing to attract Acheultani attention to this system since the end of the first incursion.
That protection no longer obtains, however. Your civilization's technical base is now sufficiently advanced to produce an electronic and neutrino signature that their instruments cannot fail to detect.
My God!
Maclntyre turned pale as the implications struck home.
"Precisely, Commander. Your son's location also explained Dahak's presence in this region. Dahak's mission was to picket the Noral system, directly in the center of the traditional Acheultani incursion route. Unfortunately, or more precisely by hostile design, Dahak suffered catastrophic failure of a major component of its inconic drive while en route to its intended station, and Senior Fleet Captain Druaga was forced to stop here for repairs.
But if the damage was repairable, why are you still here?
Because there was, in fact, no damage."
Dahak's voice was as measured as ever, but Maclntyre's hypersensitive mind seemed to hear a hidden core of anger.
"The failure was contrived by Dahak's chief engineer, Fleet Captain Engineering Anu, as the opening gambit in a mutiny against fleet authority."
"Mutiny?"
"Mutiny. Fleet Captain Anu and a minority of sympathizers among the crew feared that a new Acheultani incursion was imminent.
As an advanced picket directly in the path of any such incursion, Dahak would very probably be destroyed. Rather than risk destruction, the mutineers chose to seize the ship and flee to a distant star in search of a colonizable planet."
"Was that feasible?"
Maclntyre asked in a fascinated tone.
"It was. Dahak's cruising radius is effectively unlimited, Commander, with technical capabilities sufficient to inaugurate a sound technology base on any habitable world. And the crew would provide ample genetic material for a viable planetary population. Moreover, the simulation of a major engineering failure was a cleverly conceived tactic to prevent detection of the mutiny until the mutineers could move beyond possible interception by other fleet units. Fleet Captain Anu knew that Senior Fleet Captain Druaga would transmit a malfunction report. If no further word was received, Fleet Central's natural assumption would be that the damage had been sufficient to destroy the ship."
"I see. But I gather from your choice of tense that the mutiny failed?"
"Incorrect, Commander."
Then it succeeded? Maclntyre asked, scratching his head in puzzlement.
Incorrect, Dahak said again.
Well, it must have done one or the other.
Incorrect, Dahak said a third time. The mutiny, Commander, has not yet been resolved.
Maclntyre sighed and leaned back in resignation, crossing his arms. Dahak's last statement was preposterous. Yet his concept of words like preposterous was acquiring a certain punch-drunk elasticity. All right, he said finally, I'll humor you. How can a mutiny that started 50,000 years ago still be unresolved?
In essence, Dahak said, seemingly impervious to Maclntyre's irony, it is a condition of deadlock. Senior Fleet Captain Druaga instructed Compsent to render the interior of the ship uninhabitable in order to force evacuation of the vessel by mutineers and loyalists alike, after which Dahak's weaponry would command the situation. Only loyal officers would be permitted to re-enter the vessel once the interior had been decontaminated, at which point fleet control would be restored. Unknown to Senior Fleet Captain Druaga, however, Fleet Captain Anu had implanted contingency instructions in his backup engineering computers and isolated them from CompSense net. Those instructions were intended to destroy Dahak's internal power rooms, with the ultimate goal of depriving CompSense of power and so destroying it. As chief engineer and armed with complete knowledge of how the sabotage had been achieved, it would have been comparatively simple for him to effect repairs and assume control of the ship. When CompSent implemented Senior Fleet Captain Druaga's orders, all loyal personnel abandoned ship in lifeboats. Fleet Captain Anu, however, had secretly prepared several sublight parasites for the apparent purpose of marooning any crewman who refused to accept his authority. In the event, his own followers made use of those transports, and a small number of armed parasites when they...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.